Thank you, Frieda, for talking with me about yourself and your lived experiences today. We're going to begin at the beginning. So, my first question is about your experience in Switzerland. You were born in Cameroon and then moved to Switzerland. Why did you move to Switzerland, and what was life like for you when you lived there?
Thank you for having me here today. The beginning. I moved to Switzerland because my parents were working there, and then when my dad decided to go back to Cameroon, he left us in this small village called Le Noirmont. It's between Chaux-de-Fonds and Neuchâtel. And we grew up in a farm with my brothers and sisters, with their family that took care of us. And so we had a mom there and a dad. And my mother there in Switzerland passed away 3 years ago, but my dad is still there. And my birth parents in Cameroon have passed away. That was like a long time ago. So growing up in Switzerland was a very interesting experience because in the village we were the only black family, and people knew us very well. They were, when one of us was not seen for a couple of days, they would ask, "Where's your brother? Where's your sister?" So, I still go there a lot. I was just there 2 weeks ago. And some people remember, they still remember me. I go buy bread. They're like, "Ah, you don't get older, I'm here." So it's quite interesting to go back to where you grew up and then people still remember you, because that was also a long time ago. I just knew for sure that I didn't want to live in Switzerland. And it was a very, very strange experience growing up. I was often confused personally. I don't know how my brothers and sisters lived that. I had this experience in school where the kids bury me in the snow, thinking that I would come out white. That was very violent. And so I had a good childhood with my family, but outside of them, it was not good. So yeah, we all know those stories. There's no need to go back there.
So, what were you like as a child and adolescent? And how did you sort of navigate those kinds of experiences in Switzerland?
As a child, I loved books, so I would just read my books, and I loved skiing too. I would go out there skiing and then walk around the cows. And in Switzerland, the cows have a belt. You hear the bell the whole day. I love that. So we just go walk around the cows, and we had a farm, but we didn't have anything in the farm. It was just a place for us to live. And there was nothing for us to do except skiing. And then during the summers, we went back to Africa to see my family down there, my African family, my family actually. So it was good. We would just go back and forth, back and forth. So yeah, that has been my experience. I've been flying all my life, back and forth, back and forth. Wherever I am, I'm flying, constantly going somewhere else.
You're a traveler.
I am a traveler.
So when did you come to the United States? What and how was that transition for you?
I came to the US in 1983. I was supposed to be, I didn't speak English really. I had the high school English. My first language is French. And then, German was the language that we learned. And then Frieda, my name Frieda is a German name. And so, because Germany colonized Cameroon, where I was born.
I see.
So, yeah, and we have lots of German names. So I did not think that I would be able to speak English at all. I wanted to go study in England, but I was refused a visa to go to England. So then my parents said, why don't you go to the U.S.? Mm-hmm. You know, we look for a school for you in the U.S. Mm-hmm. And so as the first place I went to was in Minneapolis, because there, you know, the Minneapolis, I could ski there, around there. Then I went to a high school. I was already a bit, you know, older, so I went to a high school to learn English. It didn't work out. I didn't like it. And then I was skiing one day, and I met two professors from here, Marcel Rabin and Harvey Rabin, you know. And then they told me, why don't you just come to Colorado College? And I'm like, where's Colorado College? You know, because I first need to learn English. Then I come, we will teach you. So I call my parents. I'm like, okay, off I'm going to Colorado. They're like, what are you going to do there? So I came here with them. And it was in the middle of a block, one block. I don't remember which block now. And then they both worked on the paperwork to get me a fellowship. And they got me a fellowship. And I studied classes. So I was learning English with another professor, Irving Madruga. He was a linguist. He was originally from Cuba. I'm writing this story now where I'm talking about how every afternoon I went to his office, because he was teaching in the morning. And I would go to his office in Armstrong Hall. And I would see that he would make me repeat, work, walk. I could not see the difference at the time. I was like, what are you trying to say? It's like, then he's like, look at my mouth. And then, so I was, you know, so as I was trying to study philosophy with Harvey Rabin, Professor Harvey Rabin, I was also learning English, but he spoke so many different languages. Marcel was from France. He spoke French fluently, both of them. So it was great for me because I could talk to them. So he was teaching me in French, actually, as I was learning English. This is how I survived, Sissy. He spoke Italian, he spoke German, and Hebrew. It was amazing. He was amazing. He was my mentor the whole time I was here, as well as Marcel, his wife. So it was a very interesting experience for me, because so here I was among all the students. I wasn't taking classes right away. You know, I think the whole 1983 that came here, I don't remember the blocks, I was working with them directly. Mm-hmm. You know, I would go to their offices. You know, they found, I was in one of the dorms. Loomis was one of the dorms. Yeah, I was there. Yeah. They found me a room there. I was there. Then I would go to the offices the whole afternoon. I would stay in my room in the morning reading, and then I would go work with them in the afternoon. And then I would go for long walks with Professor Rabin. He had this dog. I would go, we would go for walks, and then he would talk to me about, okay, remember, this is not the end of the world. One day you will speak English like everyone. Okay, so don't be so frustrated, because I used to cry a lot. So my experience here at Sissy was, it was, at first I cried a lot in my room, because I was like, you know, I'm not intelligent. I don't know what I'm doing. Maybe I should just go back to Europe and then finish my studies there. Mm-hmm. At the time when I was moving here, I had a master's degree already in philosophy. So I had to start all over again, you know, learning the language, and then, you know, trying to fit in, trying to understand what I was doing. It was so complicated, but I worked so hard. I was just so lucky that they were there. I think for me, you know, I have been saying this over and over. Every time even I get a prize or I get a promotion, I think of the first day I met these two, and I think of the first day I landed on this campus. I mean, Colorado College really changed my life. Mm-hmm. And I don't think I would be here today without these two professors who thought that I could become somebody. They saw something in me. I don't know how, but Harvey was always telling me, well, English, So you think you're stupid because you don't speak English. He will say, and then I will cry. And he said, okay, you're going to stop crying now and just like, tell me what you read about Hegel today in French, of course. Yeah, I would say, and I would say, this is what Hegel was doing. And it was an incredible experience too. I think this is the first time I'm telling this story because I'm writing it. I'm writing my memoirs now. So I just remember Harvey constantly telling me, this is not the end of the world. You will speak English, you will be versing in English like everyone. But what I need you to do now is to acquire knowledge. I need you to master a language, your own language. I mean, it wasn't until I think I finally understood what he meant by I want you to acquire a language. Mm-hmm. He wanted me to have my own discourse and how to speak about myself and my work and the way I understand philosophy in my own words. But I did not, at the time, I did not understand that. Right. You know, it wasn't too long ago. I was writing a paper about, you know, language and silence. And as I was writing this paper, I realized why Professor Rabin was telling me. He was saying, you know, you will speak English, but it doesn't matter that you spoke the language. What becomes important in life is how do you talk about yourself, the self, right? What are your interests? Who are you in the world? He used to always ask me, who are you in the world? Do you know who you are? You know, okay, I know you came from Cameroon, but is that enough? He will always, I mean, even in his teaching, the way he taught us, he always said, yeah, I can see you struggling. And when he said, I can see you struggling, he said, I can see you struggling. You're looking for that language that will allow you to speak about the self, right? You know, I was in conversation last January with this writer. She's a Mexican-American writer. And we were both talking about writing in different languages, right? She writes in Spanish, English, I write in French, English, I write in Spanish now too, because I have to learn Spanish. And we were talking about that movement of going back and forth from one language to another language and moving around. And is you know, so it's Harvey has been, you know, I think he passed now. Last time I saw him was like years and years ago. He retired in France with his wife. Marcel passed long time ago, but they are really the people who gave me the confidence to be who I am today. And this all happened here at Colorado College.
It's amazing.
Yeah.
When you first started CC, what was your impression of the school?
I remember my first day in the class. I was in philosophy with a professor who is teaching here now, Alberto. Yeah, I saw him the other day. And so I remember I walked in the classroom, he was sitting there, and I went directly to him and I said, hello. And he just looked at me, he's, you must be a foreigner like me. I'm from Mexico. I'm like, yeah, I'm from Cameroon. And we became friends. It was just impressive because it was a small class, but the professor was just amazing. You know, he was amazing. He was, we used to go to classes from 9 to 12. I think you still do that now, no? Mm-hmm. And 3 hours just went by so fast. I wanted more. He was speaking in English, but at the time, now I could understand. I could not speak yet, but I could understand. And so that was really interesting. Then Alberto spoke Spanish and a little bit of French. So we became friends from that day on. And then there were also 2 other people in that class that I'm still friends with today. Steve Edwin, and then it was another one called Andrew Hook. So we were all in that class, I think my long-lasting friends from Colorado College. Mm-hmm. And then that day, Marcel Rabin, the professor, she told me, you should now also meet Eduardo Martinez. He's in a German house. You should go to the German house and go meet him. Then you have a court of foreigners around you, and then you can talk about your experience. It was amazing, you know. And then we went to have lunch. After that, I just went to my room to study. I was not socializing that much because I had to work so hard. Mm-hmm. I would read. Auntie Harvey and Marcel would just come and get me out. They're like, okay, don't be so obsessive. You will get it. Don't worry. So I just became obsessive with the process of knowing the language and the process of acquiring knowledge. I've always loved to read, love to write. Mm-hmm. And it's when I started writing books, it was just something that came out of me, mm-hmm. because I always, you know, wanted to do that. That first day is until today is still in my mind. Mm-hmm. And then I think it was September or the end of August the next year when I started school. Mm-hmm. And then in December, I went back home to Switzerland, you know, because I haven't gone back. Mm-hmm. And then I came back. And so it was just the block, mm-hmm. plan. So that break we had of 4 days, it was so good too, mm-hmm. because, I went skiing with some friends. And then Harvey started teasing me, saying, "No, you can't go skiing. You forgot about books." And I'm like, "Wait, but I also need to have some fun, you know." But it was just the 4 years went by so fast, mm-hmm. that when graduation time, it was just so like, okay, we're leaving already, mm-hmm. you know. And then some Alberto went back to Mexico. I went back to Europe, and Eduardo went back to Colombia. There was another one there, Pascal, mm-hmm. who he's a famous surgeon now in Germany. Mm-hmm. I think he stayed around, I don't remember. But then we kept in touch. Mm-hmm. We're still, we're still friends until mm-hmm. today.
Yeah.
You know, all mm-hmm. CC. Mm-hmm. So, the community, the people. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So.
You mentioned sort of the challenges of learning English,
yes.
right? And the frustration and yeah. the tears. I'm curious how your upbringing contributed to preparing you for those kinds of frustrations,
yeah.
those kinds of challenges.
So I grew up with, my grandparents were those first colonized subject who traveled to Europe to study. And then I grew up in a house of intellectuals, people that read books, mm-hmm. that listened to music, jazz music. And then when they left us with this family in Switzerland, they were also professors, high school teachers. So books were all over around us. Mm-hmm. And music was also a big thing in my life then. So basically, it's all I heard my entire growing up is that school is the what's gonna save you, nothing else. School, you gotta learn, you gotta go to school, you gotta learn. So I grew up with that. Mm-hmm. And my nephews and nieces today, they talk about how, oh la la, ta-ta. You know, the only thing she gives you are books. She doesn't know how to buy another books. If she's giving you money, she's giving you $50. Go buy a book. They think I'm obsessed with books.
Maybe you are.
Yeah, maybe I am. I don't know. So, So I was always surrounded by books. Mm-hmm. And I think that shaped my, my career as well. Mm-hmm. I had the obsessions like, one of my students told me the other day, well, Professor Ekotto, you can just have electronic books now. You don't need to carry them around, because I still carry books around with me. Yeah. I have this image that I'm going to be stuck somewhere and I could not like read a book. Mm. I would like, that would just kill me. Mm-hmm. When I was waiting for you today. Mm-hmm. I send a message saying, don't worry, I'm reading a book. I can't wait. I'm reading. So it's,
So you're the first African woman to graduate from CC.
Yes.
And I wonder what it was like navigating CC during your 4 years as a Cameroonian woman, given its predominantly white institution. Mm-hmm. You know, what kinds of challenges or experiences did you have directly related to your both ethnic identity as Cameroonian and then also racial identity as a Black woman?
There were two other African American students. I'm also friends with them. One, Troy Fenner, is from Colorado, actually. And I remember walking from Armstrong to go to my room in Bemis, I think, the other side. And I remember her standing there staring at me. And I just walked by, I didn't say anything. We're very good friends today. I just walked by. And then there was another one, very tall. She's an anthropologist today. And then one day, you know, we started talking, the anthropologist one. She said to me, she said, you're so short. Why are you so short? And I said, I don't know. You know, she said, all your people are short like that. She was really tall. And then the one who was staring at me, Troy, you know, we also started talking. I don't even remember how. And she said, I have been observing you. And I said, why? She's like, you walk around. At the time, I had short hair, very short, like cut like Grace Jones, you know, very short. So she said, you walk around with your head up. You don't look down. And I've never seen a Black person walking like that. And I said, what do you mean? You want me to walk? Like, I don't want to fall down or something. And she said, you just walk like a queen. And I said, I don't know. I just, also that experience, that moment stayed with me because it wasn't until one day I was reading MSC's Discourse on Colonialism, and I realized that my experience of colonialism and her experience of slaves, they're two different experiences, right? We have a common denominator, which is oppression, suffering, and, you know, vulnerability and all of that. But we have different histories, different stories. My upbringing in Switzerland and hers here were two different stories. Mm-hmm. And then when I went to South Africa also, I realized that we don't have the same kind of histories, mm-hmm. you know, within the diaspora. And I think what she meant was that I was proud of who I was, mm-hmm. and I was proud of who I was because, you know, after that experience that the children buried me in the snow, I got out, I decided that nobody would ever do that to me again, mm-hmm. and nobody would let me, like, look down on my race mm-hmm. as something negative. And I think I carried that right away from that moment. And then also my parents in Switzerland, they always told us you are kings and queens and that you belong to this world. And so I just carried that with me. And I think that made a difference when, you know, I would just walk around, like, even though I didn't speak the language, I nothing bothered me. I think what bothered me the most inside me was, like, you know, I want to know this language so that I can acquire knowledge. Mm-hmm. That was the only thing that mm-hmm. was really my problem, nothing else. And I remember students always asking me, so where are you from? How did you come here? Nah. And I kept saying, well, I don't know. I just, I was walking around and then I found these two professors who brought me here. I don't know. And, you know, we always make up a story about, you know, Harvey Rabin and Marcel Rabin. But I think I did not suffer so much like she did. Mm-hmm. She carried these complexes of being African American that I did not have. Growing up in a white family, I think prepared me to be here. I didn't have too many white friends here. Like I said, I had, Alberto was from Mexico, Eduardo was from Colombia, and then there was also a South African, Teddy Matera, who's a filmmaker. I'm going to South Africa to work with him in June with Steve Friends at CC Corrada College. Mm-hmm. And then Pascal Gazirabo, who's in Germany now, is famous surgeon. And then Andrew Hook was half Japanese, half American. He was from Boston, he's over there. And then there was a woman from Costa Rica too, who I was friends with her. And then I became friends with Troy, the one I was talking about, who asked me why I did not have any issues being around here. And then these two professors, I think Marcel and Harvey, just took me under their wing like I was their child. And they really made sure that on a daily basis, I was well taken care of, that I have my books, that I have they really took care of me. And so whenever I was super, super sad, I would just, they lived down the street. I would just walk to their house. And this is something we don't find anywhere. I don't know, maybe things have changed here, but I would go to their house every time. Just, I was there, I'm here, can you open the door? Let's go walk the dog. Or, what are we having for dinner? I would just show up. And I was not involved in like sorority, fraternity, all of that. I did not do any of that. In fact, it took me a long time to understand even how it works because I was not, interested in that. I was too busy trying to figure out how to speak the language. I read later on in a book, entitled A Foreign Student. That's where I learned about fraternity, sorority. It was written by a Frenchman. There's a film about it. That was my experience. But so I did not suffer directly from any kind of racism or any kind of, maybe students said things, but I just ignored them. Mm-hmm. I was too busy in my mind. I mean, I was like this, I was like, I could not pay attention to what was going on around me. I was focused.
You are a scholar and intellectual force in French and Francophone studies. How did your academic experiences at CC influence your intellectual interests and career pursuits? I am particularly interested in hearing if CC experiences contributed in any way to your scholarship and interest in the human condition, particularly the aesthetic potential and limitations of cultural tropes, and the concept of confinement?
Mm-hmm. That's a very good question. Yes, again, so when I graduated from CC, I got a fellowship to go study at Harvard, but I wanted to study continental philosophy. They did not have continental philosophy over there. They had analytical philosophy. And at the time, I think Harvey, who helped me get this fellowship, I think writing letters and doing my application, I guess it was just so exciting for me to go there. We didn't pay attention. So I got there to realize that that's not what I wanted to do. And, I was accepted in different institutions. So I was accepted at the University of Minnesota. They had a program there that really on something on consciousness. And then I was also accepted. I was accepted in different institutions. So I wrote them and I asked if I could come study next semester because it's already late and, and I didn't say anything to Harvey. And then we met in Paris in the summer. And then whenever we meet him in Paris, the first thing he would do, He would take me to a bookstore. He's like, okay, you need to get this, 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 this. This is what people are reading now, this, 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 in comparative literature, in theory. And so I would buy all these books. Mm-hmm. So in a way, Harvey continued teaching me, even though I was in grad school. And, you know, he continued, like, really aesthetically enforcing my knowledge of philosophy. You know, he knew every single book I needed to know. So when I will, after the summer, I would get all these books, I would start reading, and I would start my classes, my graduate classes, and I would talk about Derrida, de la grammatologie, and people would just go like, huh? How do you know that? I'm like, I was in Paris. My professor told me. So, you know, so, I mean, I think Harvey, he did this work. He really walked me through my intellectual trajectory until he retired. Even when he retired, they moved to Paris right away. And they left me all the books, both of them. So I have lots of books. They just shipped all the books to me. You know, incredible. And then once they are in Paris there, they will send me boxes of books. These are the new books you need to read. These are the books that were going on last year. So then I will show up here. I will show up there and he will say, oh, okay, I thought that I'm going to find a skinny person who's starving, who's desperate because knowledge is impossible. And I was like looking good. And he's like, oh, okay, I'm kind of happy that, you know, knowledge is not weighing you down. Very good. You know, then he would take me to a restaurant again and say, okay, you're going to eat, 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 and then we're going to go buy more books. Right. So, I mean, really, Harvey was like my professor, you know, all these years. You know, I don't even know how to... I'm thinking in my mind, how can I honor this man? I don't know. I'm still, you know, in writing this memoir, he's everywhere. I mean, his wife too, of course, Marcel, but Harvey was the person who really, you know, I remember he would make me discuss Franz Fanon, The Wretch on the Earth, or Blaskin, White Masks. When I studied grad school, I knew those books so well, right? You know, so it was, I mean, even though I read them in French, they were written in French, but I could discuss them now in English because after 4 years and all of that, you know, my English was getting there, I was getting with the program. So really, it's here where the center of my intellectual life was with this professor here at CC. I was just lucky. I was so lucky that... I think somebody called me, should we call you a Frieda Rabin or somebody like that? I said, no, don't call me Frieda Rabin because it won't work. You know, maybe you can call me a little philosopher or something like that. You know, yeah. So he did a lot. And then, you know, the author I wrote on my dissertation on Jean Genet, he's the one who introduced me to Jean Genet. And we talked a lot about issues of language, confinement. I mean, he was constantly bringing up these topics that would, like, help me navigate my own intellectual life. When I was speaking about how he kept telling me, you need to come up with your own language. You know, what he meant is that you need to come up with a discourse, something that will like, you will identify as your own, that, you know, you own. So I think I own that, thanks to him. Yeah.
How did the block plan and interactions with CC faculty influence your pedagogical approaches in the classroom with your students?
That's another good question. The block plan actually helped me also because... you know, as I was struggling with English, I had to concentrate on one topic. So that was easier for me. I would just sit there, you know, Harvey would give me all these books to read. I would try to read them. And then I haven't even talked about my experience of writing. Oh, dear me, it was like incredible. You know, he would say, okay, now you're ready to start writing in English. And I would write a paragraph and I would run to him. And he would say, okay, we need to concentrate here. You are not translating French. You are writing in English. And I would say, okay, okay, then I will go back. And so, and I will write again, and then I will go back. I mean, so it was back and forth, back and forth. So, yeah, I think the block plan for me also is like, I have the ability now to concentrate on one topic, and I will do it well, right? I continue to do that. When I have something, I have an idea in mind, I go for it. I go and I pursue it until the end. And then when I finish that, or when I feel that I have like kind of mastered it, I can, you know, I will leave it aside and I start another one. My colleagues always ask me, how do I do that? And I think this experience of studying on the block plan that, you know, helped me do that. And in my classroom also, you know, and, you know, what I like about the block plan also is that we were few students in class. We knew the professor. The professor could talk to us. And he knew each of us, our issues, what we needed to work on. So, you know, teaching large classes like at a university where I am, I cannot always do that, but once in a while I see few students that I can help, like I can really, you know, grapple with the needs, that the issues that they have, that they, you know, if they're really good and willing to do that. So that experience, I mean, also my pedagogical, I mean, the mere fact that I think, you know, I got really good mentors. You know, I've been talking about Professor, you know, Harvey Rabin, Marcel Rabin, you know, Professor Hervey Madruga, and many others, you know, they were there to help me learn. And I got a mentor award, mentorship award, maybe 6 years ago at the University of Michigan. And I think I've taken, you know, my pedagogy to the point that I work one-on-one with students a lot. Mm-hmm. You know, I'm always telling them, come to my office, we can work on this. Let me just read this for you and then we can work together. And this is what my professors did for me here. I mean, I just remember that sitting also in Professor Madruga's office, and he will read line after, like, just like a child, but I did it, you know. Sometimes my students make fun of me, they're like, you know, you want us to read out loud? I say, yeah, I want to hear. I want to hear where you're stumbling and where I can see what are the issues. You know, I learned it from this institution. And, you know, and I think that the experience you get here at Colorado College, it's really unique. You don't get it anywhere. Mm-hmm. And these liberal arts institutions, you know, you have small classes, mm-hmm. you know your professors, you know, I mean, they really walk you through, you know, understanding of concepts, right? Mm-hmm. I mean, if there's something I learn, it's from, you know, from them, mm-hmm. you know, and I try to apply it through my teaching, mm-hmm. my, you know, in the classroom.
You had mentioned the difference between your experience here at CC as an international African mm-hmm. woman in comparison to a friend's experience as an African-American woman. I'm wondering about your relationship with other international students mm-hmm. and how did they perceive you in terms of the way in which Blackness might have influenced the way in which they looked at you in terms of a comrade, in terms of commonality, in terms of international experiences, or were there some differences?
So it was really interesting how, you know, I used to hang out with international students until I met, you know, Troy, who was from Colorado, an African-American woman. And then, I can't remember her name now, the one who's an anthropologist now. But I became very good friends with Troy. You know, she never asked me anything about Africa or anything like that. She was always curious about, you know, my upbringing in Europe. And I told her, this is the story of my life. But with my other international students' friends, there were issues, you know, the Colombian one, Eduardo, was beat up one day, is so bad, it was really bad by some other white students on campus. Mm-hmm. And so I didn't really understand what went on, why he got beat up, clearly. So that was really disturbing to me. And then we also, because of it was in the 80s, there was the divest, you know, South Africa apartheid was going on. And there was this a student from South Africa, the Teddy Matera, who is a filmmaker today. So we started like camping in front of the Armstrong Hall, you know, and then lots of other students came to join us, lots of other white students to help, you know, Teddy's cause to like fight for divestment in South Africa. So that was going on. But I think that I became friends with another student from California, Jill Mazuski. Her father was a director, a film director. And she was really curious about me. She used to ask me all these questions about, so I just love your accent, I love your talking and all of that. But we became very good friends because we used to, you know, when I became kind of at ease with myself, with the language, I would go and hang out with them. But I never heard, in fact, maybe I don't remember, but I never heard a negative comments. I never heard around me, mm-hmm. except that one time when Eduardo got beat up, they said that he got beat up because he looked like, you know, not white, he looked other. So that was a bit strange to me. And that was, you know, I started talking about issues of race clearly when I was in grad school, mm-hmm. not here. I don't know why. But I also mm-hmm. remember one day, the seven of us, the foreign student, we were walking towards Armstrong. And then, we were just, I don't know where we were going, we were walking there. And I run to the entrance of Armstrong Hall and I say, one day, somebody will put my name here, Frieda Ekotto, the first African woman who went to CC. And they laugh so hard, they're like, you're so crazy. You know, who remember you? Nobody remember you. So the other day, you know, I was telling Eduardo that, you know, my name, my photo is over there. He goes, are you serious? I'm like, you have to fly to Colorado to go see that. You will see my photo there and my name is over there. So I just, you know, things like that. And, I don't know, but the issues of race were not discussed the way we discuss them today. I think there were issues there, but we never really talked about them. And I also, I mean, our generation also, I think, even if, I think my friend Troy, the African-American woman who the two of them were gravitating, like they always wanted to talk to me. We were three of us on campus, that I remember. Maybe there were others in science, I don't know, but there were three of us, you know, doing humanities, social science. So we always like even acknowledge each other, talking to each other. But Troy told me it took a long time to understand how to approach me because I was so proud of myself. So, you know, but then she said, oh my gosh, you know, you're just like everybody. I don't know why I was so scared of you. But yeah, but I don't know. I mean, I come from a generation where, you know, even if you heard a racist comment, you just swallow it, mm-hmm. right? It wasn't until maybe in the early 90s that I started to understand that racism is damaging mm-hmm. to one's psyche. I did not see that before. Mm-hmm. I also remember that my father in Africa, he kept saying, okay, you are in America, but I don't want you to go to the South. He never explained to me why he didn't want me to go to the South. And then one day I was looking at the map and I saw the South and I read a story about the South of like slavery and all of that. And I was like, this is why he doesn't want us to go down there. Mm-hmm. But it wasn't something that we talked about ever. You know, but today it's amazing how, you know, this is what is going on today. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. You know? To not talk about it. is a problem.
It's a problem.
Right. So back then, to not talk about it is what you're supposed to do.
Yeah.
Right. That was the norm.
That was the norm. We never talked about it.
Yeah.
Even if there were issues. Mm-hmm. What I found disturbing in American campuses is how, you know, African American kids stick to themselves, Asians, and here too, because once I became friends with Troy, the African American woman, people will see us everywhere together, and then also then she became friends with my other international friends, you know.
Well, I think that, you know, during the college years, there is a desire for being comfortable, in part because you're expending a lot of energy in terms of studies and navigating. Sometimes it feels complicated and hard to kind of cross over and engage with somebody who feels so different from you culturally, how they express themselves, etc. And so I think it's partly the age period, right? But we are always encouraging students to cross the aisle, to have those cross-cultural kind of conversations. But I think we underestimate the degree to which we need to scaffold and kind of create opportunities for that. It's not going to necessarily organically happen. Even nowadays, I think, even though there's much more conversation back and forth. Yeah.
You know, when I came back to CC to teach, you talked about the block plan and all of that. So when I was in 1994, when I was looking for a job in transition after my PhD, Professor Rabin invited me to come and teach in philosophy and comparative literature with him for 6 blocks. So it was from here that I got my job. I was teaching a few blocks with him, and I taught 1 block myself. And I thought the system was difficult to teach. Like, you teach 3 weeks, you barely have time to recover, then you have to start teaching again, and then you have to start teaching again. And so there were a few jobs around, and you know, I was looking for a job, and my name came up, and they said, would you like one of those jobs? And I thought, I'm not sure. I don't think I can do it. And I thought that it was a difficult system to handle as a professor. And I was also just getting out of grad school. I've been studying so hard because I did a dual PhD as well. You know, that they combined in one, but I was doing 2 of them at the same time. And so I just didn't think I could do it. Mm-hmm. And then when I came back to teach, I just thought it was so wonderful. I just loved, like, you know, I was just great to come back and teach. And
you were in a better place to be able to take advantage of
that. Now I just, I mean, you know, I could teach easily. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I'm curious about your experience as a professor and as a teacher, as a Black woman. So we've been talking about as a student, but now I'm just wondering about in what way does race and gender impact or play a role in the classroom when you work with students?
Very good question again. Yeah, you know, so I taught here 6 weeks, you know, under the guidance of my mentor, Professor Harvey Rabin. He was sitting next to me as I was teaching, because in the US you don't learn to teach. You know, you're a teaching assistant, you do a few classes by yourself, but then, you know, but you are in a classroom, you have to do it properly. So I was lucky again that he walked me through the process and I could see what to do and not to do. At the point where when I got to Michigan, the first year I didn't teach, but the second year they threw me in a graduate seminar. The graduate seminars are taught by assistant professors after 2 years, my first class of the graduate seminar. So after that experience, it was you know, I had about 16 students in a graduate seminar. And that's when I became aware that now I'm a professor, I'm a teacher, you know, I'm a, you know, a pedagogue. I have to pay attention to what I was doing in the classroom and all of that. And so I cultivated, like, graduate students right away. You know, this is how my reputation as a professor started, having all these graduate students. But then I started teaching undergraduate classes as well. And then that's where the issue started for me. As a Black professor, you know, the student would make comments about, you know, my accent. They would question my accent. They will make comments about my hair. They will make comments about the way I dress. And I had all sorts of experiences. You know, I was teaching French literature. I was teaching English literature. You know, and as I was teaching, I stopped teaching some topics, right? Like I stopped teaching this book, you know, by Flaubert, Madame Bovary. And because I couldn't like really get students to understand that, you know, who Madame Bovary was, the bourgeoisie and all of that. So I just stopped that. And I also realized that when I taught philosophy, they were very respectful. They were like, oh my God, this Black woman, she knows what she's talking about. Okay, you know, you better be prepared when you go to class. So it was different. It was really different. You know, I was teaching. Harvey was still alive, right? I mean, you know, so every class I would go to, and then he would say, how's it going? And we tell him, and say, okay. He would tell me, I think it's time for you to stop teaching this book. Start, you know, because of, so I would discuss my issues with him. And, you know, so racism got involved in some of my classes, you know, because, some students would like just, I was teaching this one class on race, racism, and ethnicity. And I was teaching this Haitian writer, Daniela Ferrier. He wrote How to Make Love to a Negro Without Getting Tired. And he's in a French academy today. The book is about philosophy. It's not. It has nothing to do even with what the title is all about. So I had an African American student in that class, who, for the first time, made me rethink the question of race. She said to me, you know, you kept talking about Black people. I'm not Black. She was darker than me. So I was like, I was pondering what is going on. She grew up in a white family. I don't know what was going on with her. After like a year and a half, she left classes. And that's where I started doing research on issues of race.
Interesting.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. You know, race, you know, racism, you know, the issues of ethnicity. So I started doing this in the U.S., and then from the U.S., I moved to the Francophone world. And then I moved to the continent of Africa. There's so much racism in the continent of Africa, but people don't discuss that. And people also think that Africans don't talk about race, but there's all over there, race, racism, ethnicity. So I started doing that research, and I shift my research agenda completely.
Interesting.
Yeah, and I also started teaching other books like Toni Morrison, you know, Octavia Butler. Mm-hmm. I changed mm-hmm. my trajectory mm-hmm. completely.
Wow.
And then I wrote that book about race in the French Atlantic, crossing mm-hmm. race and sex across the Atlantic. Mm-hmm. Yeah, you know, because I did not realize how complex these mm-hmm. issues were. Mm-hmm. It was, you know, I was in Paris with my mentor, Harvey Rabin. We were walking around talking about issues of race, and he said, you know, I think you will have a difficult time teaching from now on. This was the late 90s, and that's where the issues were coming up.
Right. As I was doing research for this interview with you, I came across this quote of yours. We must transform our institutions, both philosophically and structurally. We need to address the continued existence of white fear. Mm-hmm. To do this, we must attend to ongoing economic disparity. We must consider the discourse produced by social media platforms. We must change what we teach ourselves and our children. We must open history to all humanity. Please elaborate on what you meant and how you see higher education changing and transforming in the future.
I remember writing that. I just love those moments where sometimes I go back to what I wrote. And I was like, wow, I wrote this. This is brilliant. Oh my gosh, this is great. You know? And then sometimes I talk to myself and I say, Harvey, you would be so proud now. I can write your language. Here I am, you know. I think that what we see today, you know, we talked about how we, you know, within this institution, we, you know, when I was a student, we never talked about, you know, issues of race. You know, we just brush them under the rug and then we move on and then that was it. But I think today, it's extremely important that, you know, each institution address those questions, right? Because we all know, you know, the damage that has been done in each of us. You know, I'm here talking about, you know, people and black people, but also white people and other people, because I think, you know, the when you're talking about issues of oppressions, for example, is that at one point in the dichotomy of master-slave, the master demands the slave, do you see me? The same way that the slave demands, do you see me? You know, there's the power that goes up and down, you know, and the demand of acknowledgement, right? And I think, you know, James Baldwin said this, Frantz Fanon said this, you know, as long as we are sealed in our blackness or whiteness, we will never move on. So we need to like really start thinking about how to untangle that. And to untangle that, we have to first address those issues, inequality, diversity, you know, all these issues that have kept some people down. We need to elevate them now. So I think that, you know, in my new research, I'm hoping to do that. You know, I'm doing research now on global blackness. And this doing global blackness, this idea came to me when I was asked to teach a kind of a graduate seminar on what went on the summer of 2020 in this country after George Floyd. Mm-hmm. And I was already thinking about what happened to Trayvon Martin. I've been writing a series of essays rethinking, you know, negritude thinkers of the 20s and 30s, putting them in conversation with this generation today. What was MSZ say to me today, you know, after 2020? What would Frantz Fanon say? That's what I'm, you know, what would Senghor, that's what I'm writing these essays now, you know, putting them into conversation with the current situation of blackness in the world. I'm not only talking in the US, but in the world. So I think in coming back to history and looking at what went on during history and what is going on, we really need to start thinking about how we're going to open up those doors to everyone. We all belong to this world, where we all, this energy or this, like the air that we breathe belongs to all of us. And when I'm talking about all of us, I always tell my students, you know, when this class I'm teaching now, the few black students there, white students, I'm talking about all of us here. You know, I'm not only talking about you or you, I'm talking about how each of us understand their position in the world and how they're going to contribute to opening up history to all, because I think it's really important. So, you know, this whole thing that Harvey was telling me, you need to search for yourself, your voice. I tell my student, what is your voice? What is your contribution in this, you know, discourse? What are you going to do to make this world be better? You know, you don't want to live in a neighborhood where somebody's going to come and kill you at night. You want to live in a neighborhood where, you know, you can face your neighbor, look at them in the eyes. Like Anna Arendt said, this German philosopher, when I look at you, I see you, I see myself in your eyes. Therefore, I am human like you. So I tell them, do that. You know, think about how we can all live in a world in a better world where we will not kill each other, where we will not insult each other, a world that a peaceful world. Because as I tell my students, how pleasant it is to just walk around, stroll around, not look behind and run, you know, who's trying to kill you. Think about that. You know, this ongoing disparity, this ongoing, you know, like inequality, this, you know, we all need to do that work, all of us, right? Mm-hmm. From top to down, down to top, all of us. Yes. So, you know, for me, you know, when I'm talking about global blackness also, I'm trying to see how, you know, blackness functions around the world. We may have this, you know, common denominators of vulnerability, you know, oppression, suffering, and all of that. But we need to bring that all together and see how we can rethink our position in the world, our futures. I mean, I think Octavia Butler talks about this, right? How do I project myself in the future, knowing what I know now? You know, so these are questions that really disturb me, and these are the new research I'm doing now, and when I teach also, I was trying to tell students, trying to project all students, you know, even what I say, you know, when we're talking about whiteness, how do you see yourself, project yourself in the new world that is going to be our world?
I often talk about needing to reimagine.
Yes.
Reimagine what we haven't imagined yet.
Yes.
Right? For change and transformation. Yeah, and that's what you just described. Yeah. Yes. Yeah. Yeah. Speaking of future, what do you wish for in terms of CC's future?
I don't know. This is in my wildest dream. I think I would like to come back here and retire here. You know, I feel like I haven't given this place what the institution gave me. I have not. I mean, that's why, you know, when I'm thinking about Harvey Rabin, I'm thinking what would make him happy. Mm-hmm. I think he would want me to like be walking to class and doing my classes properly, because he was such an amazing teacher. Mm-hmm. I mean, you know, what I think also students don't realize here, or maybe they realize it well, is that, you know, the professorial body, the professors are amazing, mm-hmm. at all level. Mm-hmm. They're good professors here. Yes. Yeah. So I wish for CC to continue hiring good professors, mm-hmm. and keep doing what they're doing well with students. Mm-hmm. You know, I think what, you know, if I have to describe, for example, what maybe CC has given me courage, you know, humility. I learned to be humbled. Mm-hmm. You know, I remember the day I went to get my degree here, I was walking, they were like crying. And I just learned something that liberated me, but it also gave me like, you know, humility. Mm-hmm. So yeah, I wish CC will continue to do what they're doing for mm-hmm. students. I think CC has the ability or the power to change people's life. Mm-hmm. It changed my life, right? I mean, I think I wrote somewhere in another interview that I talked about how I learned everything from Colorado College, and then one of my professors in grad school said, "So you didn't learn anything from us?" I said, "I did, but but I studied here. I did, but you know, but you know." I mean, I will also talk about my mentor, Professor Harvey Rabin, a lot. Mm-hmm. I remember I was sitting in a class with the philosopher Jacques Derrida, and I was talking about Harvey Rabin. And then one summer we went to a conference where he was at, and he goes, "Oh, so this is a man you're always mentioning, Harvey Rabin." I said, "That's him." He goes, "I understand clearly. Where are you coming from?" I say, "Voila," you know? Yeah. No, I wish only the best. And I wish that CC, I don't know, I need to give back. I haven't given back. I need to, because I think, I also think that life is like a chain, you know? So, you know, I was at this end, somebody picked me up, And then I also need to pick up somebody and continue the chain. So, you know, I need to, I need to come and teach or do something for Sisi.
I'm sure that can be arranged.
I dream of Harvey and I say, what can I do to thank you? And, you know, I don't know. I think I was talking to Alberto the other day and said, we have to honor Harvey. He goes, I'm in his office. I've honored him enough. I teach philosophy. But what have you done? Yeah, what have you done? So I say, okay. I need to do my own too. I need to, like, maybe get your, you know, an office next to you and then we can teach together or something, you know,
That's funny. As incoming president of MLA, what do you see as the future of the study of languages and literature?
2023, I'm going to be the president of MLA. That also came as a big surprise that they put me in this position. Again, you know, this is also an important organization in the country, and we need more representations of, you know, other voices. You know, we need really to open up those spaces. They're still very confined. So I did not define when I talk about confinement all the time with languages, as well, or with language. I always feel that my voice doesn't come out. You know, I feel like there's something that was, you know, even though I speak many languages today, I write in many languages, I still feel that my voice doesn't come out. Precisely because of what I was talking about earlier, also that we need spaces, safe spaces where we can really articulate who we are and what we aspire to be in the world. And so this MLA, I have to come up with a film, you know, that will be the film for the year, for the entire, for the entire world. People will come around the world and write about this theme. So I haven't decided yet, but I'm thinking about a few of them. And I want to do something very philosophical again, because I'm thinking of my mentor. You know, as soon as I found out, I was like, Harvey, so what would you think of this? What should I talk about? You know, so yeah, I've been thinking about something very philosophical. I'm going to do something abstract. But I think that, you know, when we're speaking about languages and literature, the same is that we need more translations of text. We need more voices around the table. We need to allow other people, even if they don't speak the dominant language of English, to be heard, for example. You know, so, I mean, that's the work that is being done a little bit, but it's still very, you know, there's this writer I was in conversation with, Professor Alvarez, she teaches at, I think, Austin, Texas. She came up with this great idea. She has a master's degree in Spanish. Creative writing program in Spanish. You start the master's degree, but you do a creative writing in Spanish. That is brilliant. We need that. We need to have those in different languages. You know, that I mean, I think Spanish is an American language now. So I think that's the only program in the country. And I think that's great that you come here, you learn to write creatively in another language, you know. So, yeah. So I'm hoping that, you know, we need to push for more programs like this and to really give space to others. You know, we need to open up those spaces. You know, we need to create them and we need to open them more and more.
You have your work cut out for you when you become president of MLA. Yes. Well, thank you. This has been an enlightening conversation. I really appreciate you.
Thank you very much for having me and allowing me to talk about Colorado College and mostly to talk about my former professors, wherever they are. I know that they are still blessing me because I feel blessed to have crossed their paths. I know that. I know Harvey Madruga must listen to me say, oh, you can make the difference between to walk and to walk, to work and to walk. And okay, I'm doing it. And then for Marcel, who was just constantly there for me, telling me, get up, don't cry anymore, crying won't do it, just keep working. That's what I've been doing. So, you know, yeah.
Yes, you have.
Yeah.